Okay, so thank you so much, Philippa. Thank you all for joining and listening. It's an interesting experience giving a talk without seeing any one of you, but that is life. Thank you, everybody at Orox, to be interested in this work. It's quite cool. Hopefully, you'll agree with me. All right, so what do we do when we do Raman and or Rilwan spectroscopy? Let me show you, this is a spectrum. So what you see here is that if we shine light into a sample at a single frequency, we obviously have a really scattering that you see here. That is what we denoted by nu naught. And depending on what we are observing, light that gets scattered from the sample can have Brillouin peaks, which are these, close to the central peak, and Raman peaks, which are on either side. What they do is basically the Raman is actually a reflection on what kind of molecular bonds there are in the material. And some of these are showing what kind of vibrations are potentially possible within the molecule. The presence of this Raman peak, obviously is not a single peak, but a succession of these peaks, actually gives us information as to what kind of bonds there are in the material. In terms of the Brillouin, that's actually quite different. What Brillouin does is it gets light scattered from vibrations of the material. These are called acoustic phonons. And so what we are measuring with Brillouin, this is the location and the height of these peaks, is actually the velocity, if you are lucky, normally just the speed of these acoustic phonons that are present in the material. So they're quite different, what we are measuring. So this is, again, chemical composition. This is acoustic phonon speed. That actually also means that you can, in certain circumstances, work out elastic properties of the material. Now, if you want to measure this, what we need to do is we need to have a system which we use in terms of a modular system. Obviously, we need to have a laser source, which is not very surprising. But after that, we would have a Brillouin spectrometer, so that's a spectrometer that records the spectrum for every pixel position. Which needs to be after notch filters, and I will explain to you why that is the case. And in another channel, we would have the Raman spectrometer, or we can have a photomultiplier if you need to, or any kind of detector that detects the spectrum. So the practical realization of that is shown here. This is how we have it in our imaging center. This is all home built, and I'm going to give you a little bit of overview of these items that are here. So for example, you see the Brillouin spectrometer back here. This whole thing is built on an Olympus microscope just because that happened to be the case how we built it. We have a Raman spectrometer here, and these are the notch filters. Of course, we have our own software that we have written, which allows us to drive the microscope and get into the guts of it and get data. This is another configuration where we only have the Brillouin spectrometer, the notch filters here. This is the laser block. And in this particular situation, we have a photomultiplier here to get the light out. What we do is obviously just stick this our designed attachment here to the back of the microscope. So we are actually using this port, which is normally there for the curve illumination. And what you see here basically is that the light is launched from a single mode fiber. This way, I will give you a shakedown here. If you're vigilant enough, you realize that this was actually taken before, this picture was taken before the optical components are in. So there is a beam splitter here, which is missing at the moment. And this one here is a kinematics, Kineflex fiber coupler, which actually acts as a single mode fiber with a pinhole. This is how it looks like, and this is basically the design. It's easier if we go and look at this first. We basically have the single fiber coming into the system, which is coming from there. We have a polarizing beam splitter, quarter wave plate, This is a diacritic mirror, and that goes into the beam expander. When the light comes back from the microscope, we have an opportunity to use an SMA output for a fiber and the Brillo one. So this would be basically the output for the Raman spectrometer. And the light runs back and gets into the single mode fiber for the Brillo one microscope. To see how this is the manufactured version. And of course, there is quite a bit of design behind it. It's not so much. I mean, this is just an easy telescope. But we do make sure that whatever we are manufacturing is very accurate and it works very well. This bit is the bit that goes under the microscope. So this is what slides into this Olympus microscope. Here you see the rotating head where the objective lens is. So this unit, basically what it does, it slides in there. It allows us to slide in and out a mirror that allows us to couple the light into the microscope. And it has an electronic shutter so that it shuts the light off. When we do Brillo microscopy, we need a lot of light. So it's actually also a device which allows us to make sure that people don't blind themselves when they do this imaging mode. So for the Brillo spectrometer, we need an interference filter. And this interference filter was actually invented by Carl Patterson, who was my colleague in Imperial College when I was there. It is actually a common path interferometer, and it's I probably don't have too much time to explain this, how this works, but eventually what's happening here is half of the beam, that collimated beam that comes from a single mode fiber, so this comes from the microscope. We launch the light into from a single mode fiber, this lens collimates it, and half of the beam goes in free space, half of the beam goes inside the glass. And if we were to tweak the angle of this glass, that actually adjusts how much glass the lower half of this beam travels. After that, the light is actually focused back on a single mode fiber. So when we change the angle of the glass, what happens is that we can actually extinguish light that comes into here in a very, very narrow spectrum. So what this does, it actually allows us to knock out the Rayleigh scattered light. So the Rayleigh scattered light is the one that is would be your normal confocal microscope signal. And you can see this working. This is basically how a Brillo spectrum looks like on the camera. And what you see here is that we have a closed loop control. And these peaks are the Brillo peaks. So these are the ones that I showed you initially. And these peaks are the Rayleigh peaks. And you see that when there is no control over it, there is actually quite a lot of fluctuation. And this fluctuation is due to interference in the system, mostly coming from specular reflection in the system. But when we actually switch this on and make sure that we extinguish these peaks, as soon as this is obviously an infinite loop video, you see that when the peaks are large, we switch on the loop, and then that actually suppresses just the Rayleigh peak without affecting the Brillo peak at all. So this is very, very important that we have it. Otherwise, the Brillo peak would be swamped by the Rayleigh light, and we would not be able to see the spectrum. The realization of this modular system is this. You can see it here. We still use the kinematics couplers. We have a single mode fiber launching the light in here. The glass cube is sitting back here, and then we couple out. And then we have two servos. These are all both Zaber servos. Basically, this unit is, I would say, about 85-90% throughput. So it works quite well, very efficient, no problem at all. Now, let's look at how we actually measure spectrum. First of all, most of you who are old enough would know this picture. And the reason why you need to be old enough, because this used to be on the title of Pink Floyd CD. White light comes in, and there is a prism that disperses the light into various components. You can, of course, see this when you have a DVD or a CD. You see the same rainbow coloring. And this is all dispersion. The way dispersion works is that we need a dispersive device. So in these occasions, this is a prism, and whereas this one is a grating, so this in a CD you will have grooves and lens very closely spaced, which allows us to disperse light. Then we want to create a spectrometer. What we tend to do is maybe we can look at this one. Light comes in, white light comes into this concave mirror, which collimates the light. Then it goes into a dispersive device, which resolves it into components, spectral components, just like here. And then this mirror here actually focuses the light. And depending on what you want to do in this particular situation, it puts it onto a slit. And this particular situation, we have a concave holographic grating. So it actually does two things. It collimates, it images the light from coming from this onto your detector, and simultaneously also resolve this into spectral components. What we use is actually a very sensitive dispersive device, and this is called the virtually imaged phase array, or VIPA spectrometer. And the idea is that if you put a focus light on it, which has several spectral components, what will happen is that this VIPA will resolve this into spectral components, which are diffracted out into these different orders. This is actually just a fancy Fabry periapsilon. So those of you know how that works, that is what this is basically. Of course, there are many different designs in the literature. And you can see some of them here. Some of them are complicated, some of them are not so complicated. This one, for example, is an incredibly good setup. This is a scanning Fabry Perot interferometer that has a six-pass tandem system. This is actually was designed by Sander Koch, and I think now that he retired, there is nobody will ever be able to install any of these ever, because he was the only person who could do this properly. This one here is something that we can in principle purchase, but we don't do that because it's incredibly expensive, and in fact the quality of this is not very good. This is called a company called Light Machinery that makes this. And this is how it looks like when you open it. There is an awful lot of components in it. Notice the size is about a meter by about half a meter. So we thought that we would do something better, and this is what we designed. This is probably about, I would say, 15 to 20 centimeters one side. And what we have here is that the light comes in. We have a couple of mirrors here to follow the light beam. There is a cylinder lens to focus the light into the VIPA, which is sitting in here. Then we have two lenses and a mirror. And this mirror can actually be replaced by a grating also, if we need to do a more complicated spectrometer. And this is basically just a tube here to shade the camera so that light doesn't go directly into the camera. And we have a CMOS camera that picks up the light. Of course, behind this, there is also a ZMAX design, but what you see basically, it is just a telephoto lens configuration, 2A chromats, works very well, well within diffraction limits. So you can make it actually quite small, how we design this. All right, so this is basically how the system looks like, or at least some components of the system. So what we are going to look at now is certain applications. Now, one of my places where I work at the moment is called CELSI, which is a Singaporean Center for Environmental Life Science Engineering. And their researchers are predominantly interested in biofilms and bacteria. So these examples will be biofilm and bacteria. What we see here basically is how we use Brillouin microspectroscopy to establish mechanical properties of biofilms. And the reason why this is hugely important is because bacteria organize themselves to biofilms, and when that organize, when they become biofilm, because they are very close to each other, they are actually incredibly difficult to get rid of. So you know, for example, if you think about diabetic wounds, for example, it is known that when diabetic people produce wounds, often it cannot be cured. Often it actually results in them losing limbs and either feet or legs, feet or arms, depending on where the diabetic wound is. And why that happens is, for example, because there's a biofilm that forms over the wound. And as soon as the biofilm is formed, there's absolutely no way to save that wound, no matter what anybody does. So it's absolutely critical to understand what happens, why, when bacteria organize themselves to biofilms, why are they so difficult to mechanically hurt them? So this is what we did here, and what we see here, for example, this is a biofilm. This bit here is the, so these images are the Brillouin images, and these images are corresponding fluorescence images. And what we see here is, in terms of the bacterial measurement, this is basically measured in gigahertz, and that is the location of the Brillouin peak. And in general, larger the frequency, the tougher, the sort of less elastic the material is. And what this does, it actually looks at the biofilm at two particular positions. That positions, actually, no, this one was with time. We basically looked at where the biofilm was in the initial stage. And later on, I think 10 hours later, the biofilm basically developed further. And what they form, actually, they form these little sacs. And what you see here basically is that the Brillouin measurement establishes that this sac is really quite tough, whereas the inside where there are free bacteria, it's actually less, so it's more elastic, it's less resistant to mechanical stress. Of course, these images are, you know, we cannot really conclude much biology from just these images. I'm just showing these as an application example, so I'm not trying to do much biology here. And what this does, for example, this image here is a particular time instant where we are looking at this particular biofilm at different depth. So you see, for example, image B is at this depth, image C is at that depth, and image D is at that depth there. And what we see basically is we look at the Brillouin shift as a function of position in the cross section. So we'll see that, for example, we are at 36 micron depth right here. The elasticity of the biofilm actually drops significantly, but it's also very, very stiff at the surrounding. So this is an example for the Brillouin. Of course, we have many, many other measurements, but time doesn't allow me to do much more than this. I show you a few examples for the Raman microspectroscopy applications. And of course, there are occasions when we use both of them together, and there are good reasons for that. But again, I don't have much time to get into that why. This is, for example, what we do. So these are bacteria which are growing 16 days, 25 days, or 38 days. These are the corresponding Raman spectra as obtained by our spectrometer that we designed and constructed. And the idea is that bacteria strain believed to accumulate glycogen as it grows. And basically, these are the glycogen peaks, and we do indeed see that these peaks changing as the bacteria grow. This is another very interesting application, which is a 9-day-old culture. And what we do is we actually look at different parts of this bacterial culture. And what we see is that we actually have a significantly different Raman spectrum from spores. And to germinate it cells. Of course, we are showing the spectra here, but we can take images. But in this particular situation, the spectra are more informative because we know where we are.
Oh,
located.
No.
What happened? What was oh, no? So Somebody just said, oh no. Nobody's saying oh no anymore.
I think somebody just unmuted themselves by accident. Don't worry, Peter.
All right, no, I just thought that somebody realized how important that was. All right, anyway. This is another one which is actually quite an important project that we have is we are looking at to differentiate between different bacteria and fungus on human skin. And we are actually using AI to recognize what those bacteria are. And you see, for example, that we can differentiate between two species of bacteria, and also we can identify the fungus present in there. And of course, this is not what our system gives us, but it actually gives us what kind of bacterium is present at that particular location. We can do this in vivo on the skin, and of course, we can do it ex vivo as well. So finally, because I'm coming to an end now, I just want to show you the team, the people who are involved in this. Most of the work that I showed you was done by Matthew Rodek. Arlin did the optical design. Lawrence is the software person. And Iping is actually doing the AI. So with this one, I would like to conclude and thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Peter. That was really interesting. I was just sending a message to the chat folder to see if there are any questions coming up. I know Venkata said that it was a little bit difficult to see your cursor on one of your first slides when you were introducing how the system works. So maybe if he or she wants to ask some questions about it, then you could go over it again. However, I've got a couple of questions. So Do you correlate your images together, your fluorescence images and your brilliant images together? And how do you do it?
Yes, so we do that. And the reason why that this is what I didn't have time to say is because the brilliant signal is incredibly strongly influenced by the water content in the sample. So as long as you are absolutely certain that the water content doesn't change, you can believe that the change in Brillouin signal gives you a relative change in the elastic modulus. So this is the reason why we have to have Raman, because we need to look at whether the Raman signal predicts a changing amount of water within the probe volume. And the way how we correlate, I mean, obviously, different applications require different correlation. If we only use the Raman to confirm that there is no water change, then we are looking at, obviously, the Raman signal, how stable it is at the water peaks. And in that case, we are looking at the Brillouin signal as the information carrier. But in other occasions, for example, with biofilms, we actually look at, for example, if there is a change in the elasticity of the biofilm and whether that is actually correlated with some sort of byproduct that the bacteria produce, or what we try to work out from the Raman spectrum whether there is a chemical composition change which might have led to that, or that is a pure physical change in the biofilm.
Understood. So I guess that's why it's important to have these three techniques side by side, so you can double check everything.
Yes,
I'm not sure I understood correctly. Obviously, you have different signals from different depths in the sample. How do you obtain that, the brilliant imaging from the different depths?
So the Brillouin microscope is, because it couples into a single mode fiber, it's a normal confocal microscope.
Okay. So it's working like
so. You come out from a single mode fiber, you couple back into a single mode fiber. So it's basically a normal confocal microscope, which is a fancy detector.
Okay. We have a question coming in from Peter Call, who's going to be speaking a little bit later today. He says, I have come across Brillouin a few times for mechanobiology changes. Do you see it becoming mainstream as a technique?
I the reason why I'm hesitating is because the honest answer is no. But the reason for that is because, so the problem is that those people who are pushing the Brillouin technique, they simply don't want to understand or don't want to accept that the water content hugely influences the signal. So I think if people are willing to accept and understand properly what the Brillouin signal looks like, then it could potentially be a technique that can be used. It's very powerful because you don't need mechanical intervention. You don't need to prod the cell or prod the tissue to give you elasticity modulus. But there are so many aspects of Brillouin, including the understanding that you are actually measuring all sorts of collection of acoustic phonons that go in all sorts of different directions in the material, that unless you can disentangle where the signal comes from, it's going to be very, very difficult to have it as a quantitative method. Qualitatively, possibly, yes. Sorry, okay. It's a bit long-winded.
No, that's fine. Peter says, yes, corneal keratosis is one I've seen, but interpretation is difficult, yeah. And perhaps one last question before we move on, from Liam Rooney. We've got a couple of questions coming in now, but Liam asks, hi, Peter, with your Raman fingerprinting of bacterial strains, how similar can strains be before you can detect them, i.e. could you differentiate friendly E. coli from pathogenic E. coli?
So I actually don't know whether there is a friendly E. coli or a pathogenic E. coli. I think if it is E. coli, it is. I mean, we all have E. coli in our bodies, but they live in. So I might be wrong. I'm not a microbiologist, so if I'm wrong, just disregard what I'm saying. They live with bacteria, including E. coli, in our guts, which are not allowed to overtake us because other bacteria are also present, and the symbiosis of these bacteria, or at least the coexistence of these bacteria, prevents one strain or the other strain to attack us. We cannot do epigenetic. So if bacteria are different epigenetically only, I don't think that is a possibility that we can do. We can differentiate between them, but between different species of bacteria, we can definitely differentiate, and we use AI to do that.
Okay, cool. And definitely the last question. Stan Botchway asks, how much laser power at the sample is needed for the Brillouin spectroscopy?
As much as you have.
As much as you have, so it's a light hungry technique then.
It is very, yeah. So we use a laser which is, I think, 400 milliwatt. We have about 300 milliwatt of the sample. If we need to, we normally don't use that much, maybe 100 milliwatt. And our normal pixel dwell time, the best we can do is about 50 millisec. So Brillouin is faster than Raman, but not significantly faster.
Sure. Right, I think we better move on. Thank you very much for keeping to time.
Pleasure.
And that was a really interesting talk. I look forward to hearing more about it in the future.